I'm very excited to be able to introduce some of the folks who are here on our panel to talk about activism in the tradition of Cesar Chavez. I'd like to read a quote from Cesar Chavez in terms of thinking about what he was trying to accomplish with his movement and what he was trying to do as an activist. And so Cesar Chavez writes, "It is our belief that in working together, we are going to be able to bring justice to an important group in our land. In working together, whether black, white, or brown, it really doesn't matter because we are just one people. In working together, we will be able to bring justice to all of these people who suffer the pains of injustice. In working together as one people, we will someday be proud to know that it was our generation who was responsible for eliminating the inhuman treatment of workers and other minorities and other poor people." So I think it's in that spirit, right, that Cesar Chavez was trying to figure out, how do we create solidarity? How do we get together to be able to work together to solve the problems of the suffering and the pains in our community? That's really the spirit of Cesar Chavez's work. And I'm very honored to be able to introduce some of our speakers this evening, because I think they have worked in the community here in Austin and in Texas broadly to try to address the suffering of the most marginalized people, to try to work in that tradition of Cesar Chavez.
Good evening. I'm Susana Almanza with Poder, People Organized in Defense of Earth and Her Resources. And I'm going to start with this prayer that is in Cesar Chavez's word. Show me the suffering of the most miserable, so I will know my people's plight. Free me to pray for others, for you are present in every person. Help me take responsibility for my own life, so that I can be free at last. Grant me courage to serve others, for in service there is true life. Give me honesty and patience, so that the spirit will be alive among us. Let the spirit flourish and grow, so that we will never tire of the struggle. Let us remember those who have died in justice, for they have given us life. Help us love even those who hate us, so we can change the world. Amen. That is a prayer that we feel is deeply rooted in the struggle that Poder believes in and moves forward. And before I get started, I want to thank Greg Moses and all those who put this Philosophers for Peace conference together, and all the staff, and for giving me the opportunity to be here with all of you beautiful people here today. For those who don't know, Poder is an environmental justice organization. And environmental justice takes in where you live, work, play, pray, all of those areas. Everything that is part of our lives encompasses environmental justice. But it's also looking at nature kind and humankind, and that they're interwoven and interlocked, and that you can't separate nature from humankind. They are one big entity. And when we look at Cesar Chavez as one of the role models for farm workers, Cesar Chavez demonstrated the need for all working people to support those who are oppressed and exploited. Working for dignity on the job and in the community, increasing democratic rights of all working people, and challenging the powerful in defense of the powerless. And that's what Poder has been working and struggling. For those who don't know, in 1993, Poder took on six of the largest corporations in the world. And you might know of some of these: Exxon, Chevron, Mobil, Texaco, Citgo, and Gulf Coast Estates. And some of these corporations have married each other, so now they changed their names, right? But we took them on because there was a giant fuel storage facility in which I call the urban farms. And the urban farms where people now work, and there's industrial corporations in our communities across the street by neighborhood schools. And they were using some of the most toxic chemicals such as benzene that cause, we know it's known to cause cancer. There's no doubt it's been scientifically proven to cause cancer. These corporations were exceeding the allowable amounts of benzene that humanity can be exposed to, over so much as 75% over the allowable amount in our communities. So you can imagine that we had our community there who were actually sick. I know most people here have gone to gas up their tank and they get a whiff of that gasoline and you kind of shift around so it won't be smelling. Well, I could tell you that if you went out into this community, you would smell that. And you can you imagine living with that 24 hours a day, 7 days out of the week, 365 days of the year. And some people never left that community. And so when we look at what was happening in that community, we saw that that community was also being poisoned. So just like Cesar Chavez, he took on some of the most powerful corporations in the country in order to work and help the farm workers. So did we. We took on some of the largest corporations in the world in order to make sure that the next generation of kids would have the chance of having a healthy life and making sure that they could reach their educational potential and not be sick or damaged because they had been exposed to all these different chemicals. And like Cesar Chavez, you know, he took on the attention of what they call La Causa and the farm worker struggle for social justice. Cesar Chavez led workers and supporters on historic march, walking over 300 miles in Delano, Sacramento. Well, one of the things that Poder did was we put together the toxic tours. We didn't walk hundreds of miles, but what we did do was that we rented buses and we got elected officials, city, county, and state, representatives, community leaders to come and get on the bus, get off the bus and talk to community leaders so that they could smell the air that the community was breathing. And we showed them the runoff that was happening in the communities and how the trees were dying and how the children who had played on those runoffs had then had all these sores on their hands and what had happened to them. So though we did not have the marches, we made sure and had the toxic tours and we had the demonstrations and the protests. And just like Cesar Chavez, who worked with college members, churches, elected officials, community members, that's what we did. We made sure that everyone was there, was at the table and informed of what was happening. And in order to empower our community, we made sure that we did block captains and that we had spokespersons that not only were English speaking, but Spanish speaking representatives also, so that they could represent their community. And we went before some of the most powerful agencies that disrespect people the most, and especially if you're people of color. We went at that time before the Texas Air Control Board and the Water Commission, the county commissioners, the city council, the health department, to all these different agencies and telling the people, you know, you got to tell your story and what's happening to you. And a lot of times they were saying, but I don't know. I said, well, what would you say if you were to confront one of these people? And they said, well, I would tell them about how my kids got sick playing that water. That's exactly what I want you to do. Exactly what you're telling me, I want you to say to them. And the Spanish spokesperson, you come and you speak in Spanish. And we'll tell them they need to have an interpreter there. We're not going to interpret unless they're going to pay us. They need to find somebody to interpret what the people, the community are saying. And that's community empowerment. And what we did was, as our organization, Poder, we didn't go around looking for CPA and lawyers and in the traditional sense that you see nonprofits and their boards of directors. What we did is that we looked in the community and we looked for the neighborhood associations, and we asked the neighborhood associations to have their president or their chair sit on our board of directors. And if there was not a neighborhood association there, we helped them to form a neighborhood association. Because East Austin is big, if you haven't been here and don't know it, East Austin is a very huge community. And so by empowering those different neighborhood associations, we empowered ourselves. Because one thing this city does is practice those old traditions of divide and conquer. And what we told the community is that, no, you know, we have to support the Montauk Neighborhood Association, might be in Southeast, we're in Central East or Northeast, but we have to support them, and vice versa, they have to support us. Because only through unity are we going to be able to make these changes. And then we went to our sisters and brothers on the west side and say, you know, we have to work together because we can't do it by ourselves. We went to the mainstream environmental group and said, we need your support. We need you to make sure that you're working. We don't want you to lead us, because our motto was, we speak for ourselves. And we had seen so many times in history that when we would have white people come into East Austin, they became the voice for East Austin. And the people would say, oh no, let them, because they're smarter and they know everything. And we say, no, no. You know everything because you live there and you're just as smart. You have to be the voice, because we have to teach the next generation that they have the voice. And if they see their mom, their dad, their aunt, their sisters, their cousins and brothers speaking out, guess what? They're going to want to do the same thing. And so that's what we worked, was to make sure that we empowered the grassroots community to make those changes. The other thing was, when we talk about the chemicals in the fields, that was the environmental justice movement, the continuation of what Cesar Chavez was working on, to make sure that we stop the exposure of all these chemicals, not just like in the farm fields, because I tell you, there were new fields, and those fields were in our community. Because when we did a land use study here in the city of Austin, 95% of all the industrial zoning was in East Austin. So what did that mean? That we had all the industrial industries that use any type of chemical, heavy 18-wheelers, tracking chemicals, were all in East Austin. So we had our own farm fields here where our people were being exploited as they got up every morning around their home and as they made themselves to work. And that was a big struggle, was to make sure and try to clean up East Austin and get rid of a lot of the industrial industry. But why? To protect our families and to protect the next generation. And that was very important, that we continued that legacy. And that legacy was all done with community grassroots organizing, doing toxic tours, doing press conferences, doing press, you know, protests, going before government bodies, being on task force, being on committees, all of these different things that it took to bring a lot of these changes. That's what the struggle is about. It's a struggle. It wouldn't be a struggle. You wouldn't use that word if it wasn't a struggle. And that's what it's all about, because when you're fighting and you're seeking justice, it's a very big struggle, and you take on a big monster out there. And sometimes, you know, your toes get stepped on, but you come back around, right? You just don't give up. And I think that was the thing, is Cesar Chavez took on some of the big corporations. Sometimes you took a blow, but you got back up, you know. But Bolet has never said, we're not going to take on a case because it's not winnable. I have to say that. A lot of cases haven't been winnable, you know. And we have lost some of the cases, but in a lot of them, we kicked their ass, you know. I have to say that. We took on a giant multi-billion-dollar corporations, and we did it with a $2,000 grant from Citizen Clearinghouse. $2,000, and at every meeting, taking up dimes and pennies and nickels and quarters just to be able to make copies so that we could flyer the community about what was going on, because most of ours were about people power. And when you're poor, you know how to work what little money you have. You learn to really budget and do those particular things. And so Poder has been very instrumental in making giant changes. We also took on the BFI, Brown and Ferris Industry, one of the six major waste management companies in the world, and got them relocated. The Holly Power Plant got closed finally in 2009, and you know, it was city run, causing a lot of health issues and problems in the community, and it got shut down. So Poder has worked really hard, and one of the programs that Poder instituted in 1995 was the Young Scholars for Justice, because we recognized that we needed to be training the next generation so that when we left or we stepped aside, there was someone there to take over the organization. And I can tell you, those Young Scholars for Justice had made some tremendous changes by looking at the city of Austin and their parks and recreation facilities and looking at how the inequity that was going on, and this and showed that the recreation centers were more becoming a boys' club, and brought that to the attention to where the city then now got involved, and they started going like, oh, we gotta hire some women, and we've got to institute some classes that are for both genders. And those were the young scholars going to each recreation center on the bus every day, surveying people, looking what was happening, and making those changes. And then the mayor giving them a proclamation for the work that they have done. And they've been there to fight against peer casting, which is another, that's been a 3-year struggle to try to relocate the peer casting facility that's right across the street from Zavala, who's been emitting also pollutants from there, where our pre-K and first graders are at in a residential area. But they have taken on that struggle to write letters, to hold press conference and protest, to do door-to-door knocking. These are the things that we're teaching the next generation, is that you've got to go knock on those doors. You've got to take the step to be involved in your community. You have got to be the caretakers to continue that struggle in the community, because we won't always be here. And we want to make sure that the next generation is here in place to do those things. But I can tell you, just like everything, it takes resources. And Poder relies a whole lot on students from the University of Texas, St. Edward's, Texas State, Southwestern. We get students all the time. You know, I'm very thankful for the students. I'll always say that. They're some of the most wonderful people in the world, our students. They don't have a mortgage yet. You know, they usually don't have a family, and that'll have a lot of different worries that kind of slows you down. And they're real gung-ho about changing the world. And so, you know, I'm always very thankful to have, you know, the students working with us. And at this time, I also want to give out a shout-out to Rene Renteria, who's back there videotaping. But I have to tell you that it was Rene, when he was a student at the University of Texas, who came to Poder, and he helped produce so many of those videos that, you know, got us out into the national scope, who came and offered his services and got other people involved and was able to document so many of our struggles. Like we say, we have to document them and we have to also use them. So that's why I'm saying I'm very grateful to students, because they have a lot of knowledge and they need to share it. It doesn't no good to keep it to themselves if they're not sharing, and they're not sharing it with the community. So I do want to thank ACC and all of you for being here, and let's move on in the memory of Cesar E. Chavez and continue the struggle until we get justice. And real quickly, I do want to recognize some of the other activists that are here in the community. We have Hiberto Rivera, that's one of the founding members of Poder, also sitting there with Jane Haney. And we have Modesta Trevino here, that if she wouldn't have got arrested, we would have never had bilingual education. And Anita Quintanilla here also, who has always been on the struggle. But Rene Valdez from Resistencia Bookstore, right over here, I can tell you. And Emmett Campos. And so I want to thank you all for giving me the opportunity to talk about our work and how we honor Cesar E. Chavez. Thank you.